Really busy on Mental Health Monday over the next few weeks. So just a quick heads up that next week's edition of Mental Health Monday will be coming out on World Suicide Prevention Day. So we've spent the day with James's Place, which is a brilliant facility here in Liverpool. That's going to be available as part of next week's show, next week's Mental Health Monday. For podcast listeners as well, you're going to get a Brucey bonus this week with Dr. Susie Gage. She is behind the podcast called Say Why to Drugs. She looks at the link between drug use, different types, including cigarettes and alcohol, and mental health as well. She's a drugs and mental health researcher at the University of Liverpool. Podcast listeners will get that as part of this week's Mental Health Monday podcast, which you can download via your podcast provider, or if you've never listened to a podcast before in your life, basically it's a downloadable radio show. Type in Mental Health Monday podcast into your search engine, you'll get all the details. But my guest in the studio now is here to talk about a book, and it's a book with a difference, and I'm very pleased to say Tanya Leary joins us in the studio. Tanya, it's great to see you. Wonderful
Thank you
to see
much.
You again. Now, we've known each other for a few years.
Yeah, we have, yeah.
And I didn't know you had this in your locker.
Well, it's been in the locker for a little while, actually, because I wrote it shortly after the birth of our first daughter, Bethan, and she's going to be 7 on Wednesday. I wrote it kind of shortly after that, reflecting on my pregnancy experience and what life was looking for us post her arrival, really. But that doesn't really explain it very well, because it is sort of a kind of nighttime verse and kind of ritual which takes into account what the baby needs and what the parent needs as well.
The introduction's kind of sets it up slightly, and then I'll do a little bit of from the about this book section, if that's okay.
Yeah.
Because I get the sense that kind of sums up what the book is and why the book is. The book, by the way, is called Time for Bed Baby by Tanya Leary, illustrated by Lisa Williams. When you become a parent, it is easy to be overwhelmed by emotions, by advice from books and websites and well-meaning individuals. Bold. That's natural. You are raising a whole new human being. It is a big deal, and it can be seen as scary. This book was written for you by someone that has been overwhelmed by all of those things at some point and still is. My hope is that this verse will act as a tool to remind you to make time and take time to just be and appreciate that you honestly are doing a good job. No matter how it may look, no one gets it right all the time. There isn't a one-size-fits-all way to parent. It is part of what makes us and our babies so unique and precious. I won't give up too much more of it away, but it's all the in the about this book section of Time for Bed Baby by Tanya Leary. It comes from personal experience then.
Yeah, it does, yeah. So in the run-up to me having Bethan, I'd experienced depression and anxiety before, you know, prior to being pregnant, since my early 20s probably. And so when I disclosed that information to my midwife, she said that I would be at a heightened risk of having a postnatal depression. And that really massively struck with me throughout the pregnancy. And I was hugely anxious and hugely worried that I was going to be a complete parental fail and a fraud, and I wouldn't take to it, and everyone would be able to see through me, and it would just be an absolute, total and utter, unmitigated disaster, and it would be awful. And so I spent a lot of my time being pregnant very, very, very nervous that it would not work out for me. And I suppose looking back, that's a really sad way to spend a very, very exciting time, because we really, really wanted a baby. We didn't know that we were having a little girl, but we desperately wanted our baby. So that wasn't the situation. But a lot of people can feel that anxiety, because every book, every magazine is telling you how lucky you are and what an amazing, exciting time it is and all of that kind of stuff. And that in itself is quite overwhelming. Be grateful, be happy, be ready, be this, be that. No one is all of those things all the time. And it's very, very natural to feel apprehensive and feel scared and feel unsure. And then you've got hormones raging around your body the whole time. It's a massive deal, and it shouldn't be underestimated. And being a parent is tricky. And so when Bethan arrived and I wasn't struck down with massive postnatal depression, and I really, really enjoyed being a mum, and it was hard, and it is hard, but I just wanted to kind of ensure that is the feeling that remained at the forefront, and and anxiety and depression didn't overtake that. And so we created this little ritual, a little really special bedtime ritual where we would be together and I would be putting the day to bed, basically. So sometimes you have an amazing day and you're very grateful for that whilst the whole bedtime routine's going on. Sometimes you have an absolute horrific day. For example, one day when Bethan was little, she just rolled off the bed, banged her head on the floor. I had no idea what to do, so just ran out the house to the doctor's surgery down the road. And the receptionist just went, "Do you know you've got mascara all the way down your face?" And I was like,
"No,
that isn't my concern. I just want somebody to check." She was fine. Bethan was fine. She wasn't even, she wasn't even concerned. But I just needed someone to check it out, and it was way day, and so I went to do it.
What a terrible response.
I looked in absolute state, but it's what needed to be done. So some days you literally can't wait to end. But if you can kind of compartmentalize that into, okay, that was a hell of a day, but even that's finished now and we've survived it. Brilliant. And you go through the bedtime, book, milk, whatever. And then normally what happens in my experience is that a mum or a dad has approximately however long it takes you to get down the 13 steps from the top of the stairs to the bottom. That's your me time before you're then in the kitchen thinking, I need to clean that. I need to do the hoovering. I need to sort the washing. It's constant. And so what I'm trying to say with the book is don't just take those 12 steps, take 20 minutes, kind of try and reboot yourself. Because if you don't do that, even if today you don't feel tired, it will come. So just look after yourself, treat yourself as gently and as carefully as you're treating your baby, because you need that. Whether you think you do or not, you need it and you deserve it. And so treat yourself as carefully and as preciously as you treat your baby and you treat other people, and that will give you the best chance of being the best parent that you can be.
There's a comedian called Bill Burr, and he talks about going on holiday with his family, and he says that as a dad, he said the best bit of the holiday was the bit where he packed up the car, he put the baby seat in the back seat, and he closed the door, and he said his holiday was the time it took for him to walk then around the outside of his car.
Yeah, that's it.
To get back in. But actually, the bedtime routine is a really interesting example in terms of routine as well, that as parents, you make a decision to go, right, screens are going off now, TV's going off there, the lights are going down, the lamp comes on. You have the routine because it's designed to settle, to chill them out and get them to the point where they finally go to sleep. Have they gone to sleep yet? Not yet. Have they gone to sleep yet? No. Okay. And that's because you know that for their well-being in terms of going to bed, you can't just do everything, then throw them in bed and not expect them to sleep. But for ourselves as parents, actually, it's quite difficult to have that same sense of routine. Even though we've just said to that child, right, this is the way to go to bed and to have a good night's sleep and to be relaxed and wake up refreshed the next day. But then as adults, we then go, right, now I need to do a million and one different things.
Yeah.
But we've not practiced what we've just preached. We know the best things to do.
Yeah.
But then we don't do it.
No. And so the idea behind the book is just to remind yourself that whilst your baby is relying on you, and so if you can't see self-care for what it is, which is you are worth this time, and just give yourself a bit of love and a bit of a virtual hug and just chill out. If you're not at the stage yet where you can value yourself enough to do that, look at it from the other side and say, okay, if I don't do this, at some stage I'll be so tired that I won't be able to look after my baby properly. And hopefully, eventually, that'll tip over to thinking, no, actually, I am as important and I am worth this time. And so my hope is basically that along the way, everyone is just going to be able to treat themselves with a little bit more kindness, a little bit more compassion. And yeah, exactly what you're saying, practice what you're preaching, treat yourself in the same way that you would treat a friend, you would treat your partner, you would treat your baby, just with a bit of TLC, basically.
We've got Tanya Leary with us in the studio. Time for Bed Baby is the name of her book, which is available to get. You can get it through Amazon.
Yeah.
Various different places. Time for Bed, Baby. You'll get all the details there. Illustrated by Lisa Williams. Can I ask about the fears and thoughts that you had while pregnant? Have you sort of got your head around, or do you know whether or not those thoughts and fears, the anxieties, were based on issues that you had before pregnancy? Was it about things that you're going through pregnancy at the time? You say that maybe those fears didn't play out when the actual, you know, baby arrived. Have you kind of got your head around what was going on there? Because actually those thoughts are quite prominent for quite a lot of people. They fear that they're going to be terrible, that they're going to be an absolute show, that they're going to be, they're going to appear as ill-equipped for parenting as they believe themselves to be.
Yeah, well, I don't know. That's a big question. That I went to a grammar school with a lot of very, very capable women, and if you feel that if you feel like you don't necessarily fit within that box, and you don't necessarily feel totally prepped and totally ready, and maybe that everything is a bit of a front. It's called imposter syndrome, isn't it? Imposter syndrome. You feel that you are kind of putting on an act, and actually one day people are going to realise that you have not got your head together at all. I don't know why I felt like that, but the conversation that the midwife had with me was, you know, they only get a short period of time, don't they? And the midwife that I had said, okay, so you've had depression previously, and statistics say if you have had depression previously, then you are more likely to experience it again. And so that little tiny nugget is all I took from that. You know, there are lots and lots of things that you can do to arm yourself and prepare yourself and look after yourself to kind of lessen that risk. And sleep, by the way, and looking after yourself is one of the key ways that you can do it. But that was what I took from it. You've had it before, it's probably going to come back. And that made me incredibly anxious. And I just thought that I was absolutely going to be an epic fail. I was going to be a fraud, and I wasn't going to get this overwhelming sense of love and, you know, maternal instinct that everyone talks about and says that they get immediately. I was petrified that I wasn't going to get that. And also then I would feel so dreadful about that I wouldn't be able to communicate that to anyone. So the rest of my whole life would just be me pretending to feel something that I didn't. And that is pretty petrifying. But that didn't happen.
And I think as well, the other thing, I remember going to one of these birth bump and beyond type classes,
yeah,
down at Locum Children's Centre. And they were saying, what are your fears? And I was very much of, dropping the baby. You know, I was very much like, I physically wouldn't be able to just handle what was going on. And then somebody said in the meeting that they feared that they wouldn't bond with the child. And I thought, well, thank goodness I don't feel like that. And yet then when the baby was born, first baby, my daughter, I had this really odd sensation, which is a sensation you've never had before. And there's no other way of getting your head around it, whereby you feel absolute love for this thing that you don't know,
yeah,
recognize. I remember driving home that night and thinking, if I get back the next day and there's a lineup of babies, would I even be able to recognise my own daughter's face? No. And what does that say about me as a parent who should? Because someone goes, oh, of course, the birth of your child is the happiest day of your life. And you feel bad saying it's not the happiest day,
yeah,
of your life. It's a day where
it's a momentous day
in the timeline where you go, wow, everything changed after that. But I could highlight 10 or 15 days at least, which I could say, well, actually, I preferred it when she was 3 years of age. We took her to, you know, we took her to Clandidno Beach, and we spent a day on the beach. That was a much better day because I didn't feel dreadful. I hadn't had 3 nights of not sleeping with false alarms and pregnancy.
Yeah.
And this was just me going through this. Obviously, for my wife, who physically had to go through it as well, was much, much worse. But you sometimes feel like you've got to say, oh, everything's wonderful when they're born, and you know, you see the image of the new, and you think, oh, and really, you know, for the mom, the hair's scraped back, they've not had a shower for days, there's all sorts of stuff going on downstairs. The dad's just thinking, why are you giving me the child?
Yeah.
I don't know what to do with it.
There's a lot. There's being pregnant and then having a newborn, in any circumstance, in any relationship, just turns everything upside down, because you need to look after yourself. you need to think about the baby. And then, you know, you're getting visitors, you want to be, we're still all a bit British about it, aren't we? And we want to be polite. And so you're allowing 10 people through the doors when really all you want to do is go to sleep. In France, clever French people, they don't really get out of bed for 2 weeks. Full marks, people. Full marks. They have, and it's becoming a bit more of a thing over here, but they have basically what's called a baby moon, which is not in the kind of go off for a spa, you know, in the fortnight before you do. It is, listen, I have just had a baby. I need to get to know the baby. I need to get to know what our routine is going to look like. I need to rest. I need to recuperate. And if you are coming, that's fine. I will not be making you tea. I will not be doing the laundry. I will not be putting a fish pie in the oven. If you're coming to my home, you need to bring all that with you. And if not, don't bother. So maybe we need to get a bit more French about it.
I think so. If you ask my three-year-old what's the happiest day of her life, it would be the day after her brother was born. Not because her brother was there, because we said, you know what, we're not going to do what we did last time, which was invite people around. Yeah, come round. Oh, one's left. Oh, great. Somebody else is here. Have we got any mugs left? No, I have to go and clean the mugs. Have we got bottles and all? None of that. So we just said, you know what? When people text back going, oh, let us know when you're free, we just didn't reply to anyone. So born on the Friday, the Saturday, we had a movie day.
And
we said to my daughter, I said, you can wear your pajamas all day. We're going to get the duvets from upstairs. We watch as many DVDs as you want. And she now, you know, the prospect of a movie day, what do you want to do today? Can we do a movie day? I don't want to stay in my pajamas all day. But it was based purely on that. Because you think, well, I don't then have to deal with all those other things.
And it's important, isn't it, to get the balance right? Because that community of people will be your support network as well. But, you know, parents, siblings, extended family, everybody needs time to get used to the new routine and how that's going to look and how that's going to feel. And on some days you might feel like you could skip to the shops in your size 10 skinnies or whatever, but on other days you will very much feel like you just need to be in, you know, your fattest Joey Thanksgiving pants ever and not seeing anyone for a good while. You know, we're getting into the phase now, aren't we, where people are being more open about mental health and it's okay not to be okay and all of that kind of stuff. So it's really important that people check in with the way that they're feeling. Am I up for seeing people today, or am I actually saying yes because I feel bad about saying no because of the way that it will impact on them? You need to think about you, and we're now in self-care September. And so that it's a particularly important thing. I'm not suggesting that we want people to be hurtful or anything like that, but you just need to be a little bit self-aware. Look after you, because if you allow yourself to burn out, then that will have a knock-on effect on everyone else. And you are in charge of preventing that from happening.
Yeah.
But only if you see yourself in the same way that you see other people, you see your support network, basically.
If you can bring a child into the world, you can slam the door in Auntie Jean's face.
I would never slam the door in my Auntie Jean's face.
We've got Tanya Leary with us in the studio. She's got a new book called Time for Bed, Baby. As you read through, it's a little sort of bedtime story, which talks through some of the issues that all parents will know when it comes to bedtime, with towels and hugs and stories and those little funny egg things that sit next to your bed. But then at the end, there's a little secret, and that's the bit which is for the parent as well. Now, my three-year-old Tanya's at the point where she'll be going, Daddy, you've not finished. There's more pages now. But you go through to taking care of yourself. Too often, the idea of mums taking time out just for us is seen as self-indulgent. And too often, that message comes mainly from ourselves. The following yoga and relaxation sequence has been put together, especially for this publication, goes into the details of that, including the involvement of Lush Tums, who are leading experts in birth preparation, pregnancy yoga, postnatal yoga, and classes for children and their grown-ups. It is about giving yourself a space at the end of the day to allow yourself time to relax, recharge, and let go of whatever has come before that moment, so you are ready to give again tomorrow. That feeling, when you forgive yourself and think, you know what, I do need some time, when you then have a little bit of time, Tanya, what does that feel like? Does it feel like you've done something guilty, something forbidden, something that you probably shouldn't have done? Or does it make you think, oh, that was worth spending a little bit of time doing?
I think it depends on your frame of mind and where you are along that. So some days me doing something just for me is perfect and amazing, and I don't have a problem with that at all in any way. And but sometimes I do partially do it so my children see me doing it. So sometimes me time is me going out for a run. And sometimes I go on days when I really, really don't want to, but I want my children to see that exercise is important, to see that it is part of my routine, and to see that, you know, I make time for that, because I want that to be something that is so normal for them that they just accept that and they value it for themselves as well. The other day when we got back from holiday, I should have been doing you know, the laundry and the towels and the school prep and all of that kind of stuff. But my lovely mum had left me a copy of Good Housekeeping. And so actually, I just sat down for about 40 minutes and had a little flick through that, and felt zero guilt about that at all. Zero. And obviously after a holiday, you know, you might expect that you wouldn't need it. But holiday laundry, that's no fun for anyone.
No, not at all. And the sort of the exercises that are included in it, by the way, you don't have to be an expert in reflexology like that.
Not
it's really
at all,
straightforward
not at all.
Stuff, isn't it?
All of the yoga moves have been put in there specifically thinking about the way that a parent kind of carries a child, especially a new child, especially if you're breastfeeding. You know, your shoulders will be hunched and you'll spend a lot of time leaning over, and so it's really, really important that you're able to open your shoulders back and kind of open your heart a little bit, and also flex your hips, because you know you've been carrying a lot of additional weight. You know, some of that will be baby, for me a lot of it was cake, but you need to be gentle with your body, and all of those poses that are in there are really simple, very well explained, and also they take into account just a couple of minutes of breathing in through your nose and out through your mouth. That is enough to kind of reset you. But one of my favorites, and this is probably the laziest yoga pose that exists, is called legs up the wall pose, and that is exactly, you know, total Ron Seal. Does what it says on the tin. You put your legs up the wall, get your bum as close to the wall as you can, and that will just encourage all of the blood to flow back down the legs. So your tired legs will just get a bit more reinvigorated, and your blood will become more oxygenated, and you'll feel a little bit more human when you get up. So that, for me, just before you go on the school run, is absolute dreamboat.
We mentioned before, you know, the classes that you do, people sign up for NCT. There's the yoga that comes with it as well. Often it's a baby massage gets used as well. And a lot of those things are great. I remember, though, the focus of those classes, and the focus is a lot of the literature, was all about car seats. It was about swaddling. It was about sterilization. It was about feeding. It was about breastfeeding. It was about the benefits of it. It was about the worst signs. It was about routines and things like that. The practicalities, if you like. And also, you know, these are the things so your newborn child doesn't die. You know, these are, you know, understandable as well. Would you advocate that maybe actually that when we have those classes, and I know it is included in many different ones now, that actually well-being of the parent should get a little bit more of a nudge? Of course a child is going to be the priority and the parent knows it as well, but there's got to be a time where you think, well, I need to prioritize my own well-being. Otherwise you end up down a pathway where you're no use to anyone, particularly your newborn child.
Yeah, I think that stuff generally is massively, massively, massively overrated. We have been having children for thousands of years. And a lot of people did it without a trip trap. A lot of people did it without an amazing pram or cot or, you know, stuff people can manage without. You cannot manage if you are not okay. But, you know, preemie babies arrive all the time and the parents don't have time to go and get all the latest gadgets. You don't need that. You need to know how to check in with yourself, how to relax and spend time with your baby. The most fundamentally important thing that I think that you can do is chill out, have some skin to skin time with your baby as much as you possibly can, and just relax. But obviously I'm a mum of two, you know, five and soon to be 7-year-olds now, that is very, very, very easy for me to say now. When I went home with our first baby, you know, like I was as scared as a kitten, and I was glad to have the gadgets and all of that kind of stuff. But I do think that one of the most important things that I think that you can get, which supports well-being and all of that kind of stuff, is a sling, because that means that you can, you know, have your baby with you and do all the bonding and all the lovely stuff that is really nice to do, whilst you're able to take time and look after yourself as well.
And it doesn't take a lot of time, does it, to figure that out? You've got all this stuff and you didn't really need it. Even, you know, I remember my mother-in-law said to me, she went, you only actually need three vests. You need one that they're wearing, one they're going to wear next, and one that's in the wash.
Yeah.
You only need three. So when you buy it, when you get like these suits and all kinds of, you don't really need those whatsoever. But there's so much, you know, emphasis on the sort of the business, if you like, of this travel buggy, travel system, sorry.
Travel system,
I don't call them,
yeah,
prams anymore.
Yeah.
Travel system is like, this one, for an extra £500, has this extra setting, which you'll need for the first 3.5 days.
Yeah.
After that, it'll go into the attic, and then it'll be worth nought, because you'll then try and sell it through Gumtree or eBay, and someone will go, well, why would I need to buy that?
And also, my baby's really precious, so I'm getting a brand spanking new one. Thanks for yours, that's only been used for 3 days. I'll be getting a new one. Will you, you clever old bean?
Yeah, they say, oh yeah, they say you shouldn't get pre-used anything. It's like, I think that's for mattresses only, isn't it? Mattresses and car seats,
yeah.
Apart from that, most stuff that's available secondhand is normally okay as well. And the other thing is, and I've never quite got my head around another way of explaining this thing, and I think you touched on it in the introduction to your book, is that idea that if you feel like everything is going wrong and you feel like you're not good enough, that's absolutely normal.
Yeah.
And I've never quite thought of a way of explaining that to people when they go, oh, you feel absolutely dreadful, you feel like you can't sleep. Great, that's how everybody feels. Because I often think, you think, well, haven't we come up with a better system? Haven't we come up with a way of figuring out how to stop people having to feel so low, so that if there maybe is something wrong, we might get an opportunity to correct it, if you like.
And yeah, but I think there's a fine balance, isn't there? Because I think, and I used to work with a lot of teen parents that had come from kind of not successful parenting situations themselves. And they, you know, were very down on themselves and very anxious and worried. But generally speaking, if your brain has got the capacity to worry that you are not doing a good enough job, that is because you really, really care about doing a good job. So I think that is sort of a barometer. You know, I'm anxious about looking after my baby. Well, that's good. You want to do a good job and you are a caring parent. And that, an illustration of that is that you're worried, but I do not want it to tip over into massive anxiety. You know, there's sensible levels of worry. And then there's the kind of ongoing low level or high level anxiety, which just gnaws away at your stomach and has your brain telling you stories that you're not good enough and that everyone else thinks you're a fraud and this, that and the other, and you're not really capable of being a parent at all. All of those things are over and above what you should be experiencing.
Well, our health visitor, second time around, made a much more blatant point of saying, when she came around for the visits in the home, and how are you feeling to mum? Not like, and how do you think you're getting on? It was, and how are you feeling? Like, literally, tell me if you have these thoughts. You can have those conversations afterwards as well. It's been really well received, the book.
Yeah.
Not just through 5-star reviews as well, but there's different organisations who want to kind of make it part of their rearing systems. Going on, what sort of things going on?
Well, yeah, so Home Start over on the Wirral are taking it for a pilot in October, because, you know, there's a lot of social anxiety and social isolation for younger parents particularly. There's been a lot of research around that, and those parents are deemed to be the least likely to kind of make time for themselves. And I really, really want this book to get into the hands of the people that are least likely to kind of find it themselves or buy it themselves, because people that are my age and people that kind of my peer group are pretty well versed in self-care, whether they practice it or not. They at least know that it exists, and they know that they should be doing it or could be doing it taking time out and things like that. But there's a whole group of people that don't realise that that's okay. And it's most important to me that it gets to them so that everybody understands that they are of value and they can only care for their baby by caring for themselves. So yeah, hopefully it'll go well with Home Start.
Time for Bed Baby is available to buy now. It's available on Amazon. Tanya Leary is the author. She's our guest today on Mental Health Monday, illustrated by Lisa Williams as well. If you know someone who's about to be a parent and you've got a copy, lend it to them, or even better, buy another copy.
Buy them a coffee.
So yes, that is the official message from the author.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful to see you. Thank you for your time, Tanya. Thanks for joining us on the program.
Thank you very much for
We'll get Tanya's details up on our social media so you can check out the work that she's doing as well, and various tweets and blogs and everything in between you with Radio City Talk.